assume that starting with a basic feasible solution is an easy problem, but it's not always the case. If you take that problem, okay, which is a standard form, you convert it into the slack form, the solution that you have here is not a basic feasible solution because, as you can read, x4 is equal to minus 4, which is not allowed here by the non-negative constraint. So this is not a basic feasible solution, and sometimes when you are not very lucky, which is the most frequent case, of course, you don't have basic feasible solution to start the simplex, iterating with a simplex and start pivoting. So what we do in that case is we first solve a problem to find a basic feasible solution and find one vertex of the set of feasible points inside my polytop. And we have a recipe for doing that. The first step of the recipe is to put all the variables to the right, okay, so that we have only constraint of type 0 equal to something. Okay, so we put all the variables to the right. So for instance here, I will put x3, I will have minus x3, x4, I will have minus here x4. And then just make sure that the coefficients are 0, okay? So I put a non-negative here. They should be positive, okay? And you can always do that by putting a negative sign on the left hand side of the equality and to the right hand side of the equality. You can always make sure that these two and four are non-negative, are positive. Okay, once you have that, you will introduce one variable to represent, to replace the zero here, and it will be x5 and x6, for instance. You introduce one variable, so you will replace here the zero by one variable, x5 and x6. Okay, ideally, we would like x5 and x6 to take the value 0, right? Because it used to be 0 in my initial problem, so x5 and x6 should tend to 0 as well. And this is why what I want to minimize is I want to minimize the sum of x5 and x6 until the sum of the two variables would become 0. Okay, so I want to minimize x5 and the sum of x5 and x6, which is equal to maximizing z, or the negation of the sum, so minus x5 minus x6. This is totally equivalent. So if I'm able to solve that problem up to optimality, then I will find a basic feasible solution. What is interesting here is that it's a linear program. This one is also a linear program, and this is also a very nice slack form. But by construction here, for this subproblem that I need to solve first, this is a basic feasible solution. I've got a basic feasible solution. I can start pivoting on that problem, find a basic feasible solution for my initial problem, and then start pivoting on my initial problem. Okay? Just to make sure here that we are on the same page, this is not yet a basic feasible solution here, because I'm not allowed to have x5 and x6 here. So of course I will replace the expression for x5 and the expression for x6 here in my objective function as well. So if I have minus x5 minus x6, okay, it will be minus 2 minus 4, and this is why here I've got a minus 6. For the variable x1, you've got minus x5, so you've got 2x1 minus x6, 2x1 minus x1, it means 1x1, and so on, okay? And you also have your initial objective, okay? And the initial objective, you will apply on it exactly the same transformation along the pivoting that you will do to start and find the basic feasible solution, okay? Once you have that, you simply get rid of this line and you start pivoting on the line which is your initial objective function, but you will have it with a basic feasible solution. So let's summarize. The simplex algorithm is a two-step method. You first find a basic feasible solution, and it's very elegant because you solve also a modified problem with a simplex algorithm for which it is easy to find a basic feasible solution by constructions. Once you have it, you start optimizing and pivoting for the basic feasible solution that you just have found before, and you do that for initial problem, of course. There is a slight problem, a slight risk with the simplex is that you might have what we call a cycling problem. Okay, it means that you will pivot and you will not be able to improve the solution and you will enter into what we call an infinite loop. To avoid that, there is one simple rule that you can apply, which is the Blunt rule. In case you have two variables that you can choose to pivot with, always choose the variable with the smallest index first. We call that the Blunt rule, and this will avoid the infinite loop problem and the cycling problem of the simplex. Just a few words about the simplex algorithm. In practice, the simplex algorithm is quite fast, okay? Usually its behavior is what we could say a polynomial time, okay? But for some problems, some very strange problems, it was shown that it could have an exponential worst case time complexity, the simplex. It doesn't mean that linear programs are complex and are NP complete. It doesn't mean that. It's simply the simplex algorithm that has sometimes an exponential time behavior, but most of the time it's not the case. But linear programs are easy to solve in the sense that it's not NP hard. Polynomial time algorithm exists, like the ellipsoid or the interior points methods. Okay, and those one, you have the guarantee that they will be able to solve the linear program in polynomial time. But still, the simplex is used a lot because it's not too difficult to implement. And it's also a very nice approach because it's incremental. If you just slightly modify the linear program, for instance, by introducing one new constraint, then it's easy to re-optimize the problem that has changed a little bit. And you can do that very quickly. Some problems that are very well solved by linear programs are the minimum cost flows. Okay, we will have one lecture dedicated to flow problems, but the minimum cost flow is a problem in a graph where you have a source and a sink here, and you want to maximize the amount of flow that you will send from the source to the sink, but you have capacities. Okay, you have capacities on each of the edges, and you have a cost. Every time you send one unit of flow on this edge, you will have to pay a cost of 2. On this edge, it will be a cost of 7, and so on. And so you want to accommodate as much unit of flows from the S to T at minimum cost without exceeding the capacity constraint. These problems are very well solved by the simplex algorithm as well. Okay. Integer linear programs, not linear program, okay? Linear programs, this is easy to solve. But if you want the solution to be integers, okay? This is what I represent here as the points, the black points here, okay? If you want the solution to be on the grid, so it is an integer linear program, these problems are very hard to solve. They are NP hard. Okay? So simply because of the difference here, if you require the variables xi to be in the set of the real numbers or it should be an integer, simply because of that, the problem becomes difficult or is easy. The way we will solve this kind of problem is using branch and bound, but as you can imagine, the relaxation that you will use is the linear program upper bound or lower bound, which is used, and we will apply this lower bound, we'll compute this lower bound with the simplex. So, assume that we have the problem in which we relax. So instead of having xi belong to n for all the variables, we will relax that and we will say that it belongs to R. Okay? If we do that, we have a linear program. Okay? So this is, for instance, the root node of the problem. Okay? And we relax and we require the variables to take a continuous value. We solve the simplex problem and we realize that some variables, okay, let's say xi is equal to 0.7. Or let's say that it is equal to 2.7. Okay, it's 2.7. The problem is that it's supposed to be integer. Okay, it's not supposed to be a floating point value in the initial problem. So we will create two branches. We will create one branch here in which we say that it should be less than 2, and one branch here in which we say that it should be larger than 3. So we have decomposed the problem, and again we will solve here the simplex to compute a lower bound, and we will solve the simplex here. We'll use with the simplex, we'll find a lower bound on that node. Okay? And so every time we add a branching constraint like this one in the branch and bound search tree, we will increase the lower bound and we will have a better chance of pruning the best feasible solution that we have found so far. Okay, it will bring it, and by adding this constraint, the lower bound here will increase and it will increase here as well. So this is the way we solve what we call integer linear program. We use branch and bound, and we use a simplex and linear relaxation in each of the nodes of the search tree. And to explore the search pairs, we will add integrality constraint like this one. Okay, every time we pick one floating point variable, and we take the floor of this value, and we say that it should be less than the floor and larger to the ceiling of this continuous value to the right. The inventor of the simplex was George Danzig, and he invented this approach for solving logistic problems during the Cold War. Okay, and so this was during the Second World War that this approach was imagined by George Danzig. If you want to practice a little bit for the exam, you can, for instance, try to optimize this slack form to optimality. As you can see here, we already have a basic feasible solution, and this will be a nice exercise if you want to practice a little bit on the pivoting operations. Another exercise that you can do is transform this problem into a slack form and try to find a basic feasible solution, and then apply the simplex to find the best possible solution. Okay. If you want to make sure that you have the correct solution, it's quite easy to see because you have three variables, so you can always represent the polytop. Sorry, you can always the polytop in three dimensions to convince yourself that you have found the best solution to this linear program. Linear programs are ubiquitous. You can meet integer linear programs in many different situations, for solving logistics problems, for solving scheduling problems, for solving timetabling or rostering problems. And this is why big companies have developed softwares. And the most famous and the most efficient softwares, you have to pay to access to them. There is the one that is developed by Fico, one which is called Gourobi Solver, and one that is developed by IBM. This is called Cplex. And you have Python interfaces, but you can model these problems in every languages actually, but this is just to show you the Gourobi Python interface here. It's quite intuitive, okay? You create a model, you can add the variables here, okay? Then you can add the constraints, and the constraints, you model them quite easily like this, okay? You have a sum over all the variables ij, and you say that it should be less than the capacity, okay? You can add the constraints to your model, and then you just call optimize, and then you can print the solution here at the end, okay? And you can retrieve them like this. Okay, so in just a few lines of Python, you can model a linear program, for instance, here using the Gourobi solver. For the exam, what I expect from you is you should be able to formulate a linear program. You should be able to transform a linear program into standard form and slack form. You should be able to explain and find a basic feasible solution. And of course, you should be able to apply the pivoting operation to improve one solution and to move to the next one that is improving the objective function. And you should also be able to explain how to detect unbounded objectives, which might also happen, unfortunately, for some problems that are a little bit ill-conditioned. If you want to read more about the simplex algorithm, this is the chapter of this very famous book about linear programs, about algorithms. You can read that chapter, okay? And if you want to know a little bit more, you can always follow this course by François Gliner that is dedicated to that topic at UCL.